Good morning to all the students. Yesterday we have discussed some of the key concepts of object-oriented programming. We have gone through various introductory concepts related to C++. And yesterday we have seen two important concepts that are related to object-oriented programming, that is class and object. Right. And in today's session, we'll continue with the same key concepts of object-oriented programming. Like, we'll discuss the inheritance concept, polymorphism, data abstraction, and encapsulation. So we'll just go through what actually are these concepts, what inheritance is, what polymorphism is, what data abstraction is, and similarly, what encapsulation is. So we have the separate topics in each and for each and every topic in different units. We'll go deep into the discussion when we once reach those particular units. So right now we'll discuss what actually these particular concepts are, nothing more than, right? So yesterday we have started one, if you consider the key concepts of object-oriented programming, yesterday we have discussed the class and object. Can anybody tell me what a class is? Give me a single word that represents a class. What actually is a class? What is that one?
Blueprint.
It is called as a blueprint of some problem, right? Or it is also called as prototype also. We can also call it as prototype. So what actually is an object?
It is an instance of a class.
So it is an instance of a class. So as I told that the class and object are interrelated, they have a very strong connection. The connection between them is you can create a class, you can create a class, but you cannot use that class without creating an object, right? So class becomes useless without objects. Similarly, you cannot create an object for an undefined class. So if you don't specify the class, it is impossible to create the objects, right? So both of them are interrelated and they are dependent on each other. This is the relationship between a class and object, right? So as we are saying from the first day onwards, the difference between the procedure-oriented programming and object-oriented programming is the object-oriented programming has included many features that are helpful in designing the real world problems, right? So the most important concepts for designing the real world problems are this class and object, right? Can anybody, what is the syntax for class declaration? How do you declare a class?
Class name.
So it starts with a keyword called class. And you should give a name to that particular class, which is specified as class name. And whatever members you define, these are called as fields or properties, right? So we have some fields, n number of fields. And we have methods, right? Proper. And these methods, and we end it with a closing curly brace, and you should definitely end it with a particular, this is called as semicolon, right? This is how we declare a class. This is the syntax of a class, right? As we know that these are fields. The field specifies the properties of a class. It's not the properties of class. Actually, we should say that these are the properties of an object, right? So we can create any number of objects for this class. So if you declare a class like this, we cannot make use of this class without creating an object. And you, if you create an object, you can make use of these fields and you can make use of these methods. You can invoke these methods. All these things you can do only when you create an object for the class. Without creating an object, it is impossible to use these fields. It is impossible to invoke these methods, right? So may I know what can be the fields? What are the entities that we can give for these fields? What actually are these fields?
Variables.
Super. Right. These are variables. These are variables, and we can say them as the properties of the object. Right. So you can specify some two properties. For example, I want to declare two variables int height and width. So these two fields are these two are called as the properties of the object. So how many objects you create for this class? Let us take one example. Let class ABC and I want two fields here, int height and int width. You can specify any data type, nothing wrong in it, right? So let us forget about let us say read is one method and write is another method. So this is how I specify a class. This is an example. Right. So height and width are the fields, and read and write are the methods that I have defined in class. And as I told that these particular fields and methods are useful whenever you declare an object for this class. So how do you declare an object for a class? Right. There are two different syntaxes. Yesterday we have gone through only one syntax. There are two different syntaxes. Right. And one more question I want to ask you is, can we call this type of class as a data type or not? First of all, tell me what is a data type. What is a data type? Anybody please respond, what is a data type?
It specifies the type of variable.
It's not the type of variable, Amma. It is the type of data which you are going to store in the memory, right? So the name itself is specifying that it specifies the type of data, right? So what type of data you are going to store in the memory. Similarly, it also specifies the total memory. First one is it specifies the type of data. What do you mean by type of data? Whether you are storing the integer data, whether you are storing the decimal values, or you are storing the characters, or you are storing the strings, that is specified by this data type model. Similarly, it also specifies the memory space. Right. If you go to the C concepts, for example, if I take the data type as integer, what is the size of an integer in C? How much memory will be allocated for integer? How much, Amma?
2 bytes.
Not 2 bytes, it is 4 bytes. Right. Even 2 bytes is also correct. I'm not saying that your answer is wrong, right? But since we are using the latest compilers, and the latest compilers work on a 32-bit system, therefore the size of integer is considered to be a 4 byte, right? But if you work on a old compilers or old systems, then definitely your answer will be correct, right? But latest, we are making use of the latest compiler. That's the reason why it is the integer takes 4 bytes, right? So here int is a data type, right? And the integer specifies that it should allocate, it means the compiler should allocate 4 bytes of memory in order to store the integer value, right? Similarly, another important point, nobody will specify this one. We know what data type is. It specifies the type of data. That means it specifies integer, float, or character, or string. And similarly, it also specifies memory space. Many people will discuss these two points. But other than this, the data type also specifies the valid operations. The valid operation. Right. Have you gone through the first unit of data structures? Have you completed the first unit of data structures?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No. The first topic itself is ADT. What do you mean by ADT? If you go through the syllabus of this data structures, the first topic itself is ADT, which is called as abstract data type. Right. We'll see what this abstraction is. Why? Because we also have one concept called as abstraction here, data abstraction. Right? We'll see what abstract is. But we should know what a data type is. When you study the data structures concept, you should know, or when you go through any programming language, you should know what data type is. And one of the important strength of this object-oriented programming is, as we have discussed in the previous session, that it supports strong type checking. So we should know what a data type is and what data type specifies, right? So two points we know already. One is it specifies the type of data which it is going to store in the memory, and it also specifies how much memory is required for each and every variable, and it also specifies valid operations, right? What do you mean by valid operations? For example, if I take two integer values, 10 and 15, listen carefully. These are two integer values. Am I right or not? 10 is an integer and 15 is an integer, right? Now, can anybody tell me what are the valid arithmetic operations on this 10 and 5? What are the valid arithmetic operations?
Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division.
Addition, subtraction, multiplication.
Modulus.
Division and modulo, right? So other than these are the arithmetic operator category, right? Other than this, we can also make use of the relational operators. Other than this, we can also make use of the logical operators. So, but let me confine myself for this discussion point of view with these only arithmetic operators, right? Now, if I take two floating point values, 13.5 and 12.4, these are floating point values. Now, can anybody tell me what are the valid arithmetic operations that we can perform on these floating point values?
Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division.
Addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Now, those who have answered now, you please try to speak loudly. I couldn't hear your voice, right? So the answer is perfect that we can only perform addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division operations. What about modular division? Can we perform modular division on decimal numbers?
No, sir.
No.
No, sir.
No, right. So let us define what actually data type is now, right? What are these 10, 15, and what are value you take, right? You have some set of values. Am I right or not? Integer means you have some set of values starting from negative integers, and you can also give it the positive integers up to infinite. Is it right or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. And it consists of set of values, and it consists of set of operations, right? So if I consider the integer data type, does it contain set of values or not? Contain from minus infinity to infinity, you can take any value from that particular set, right? Similarly, it also consists of set of operations, valid operations that you can perform on these values. This is very important, please listen carefully, right? So it also consists of set of operations that you can perform on these values, right? For example, what are the valid operations, arithmetic operations? Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and modular division. Similarly, if you define the floating point numbers, if you define the floating point data type, float data type, does it contain a set of values or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, right. Does it contain set of operations or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Right. Yes, sir. So, if you consider the set of operations on this floating point number, then modular division is not valid. So you can say that some set of operations can only be performed on this set of values. So if somebody asks you, are you clear about this concept?
Yes, sir.
Right. So if somebody questions you what actually is a data type means, you can blindly say that the data type consists of two important things. The first important thing is set of values. And the second important thing is the set of operations or methods which you can perform on those values only, right? So two important points: set of values and set of operations. That's it. The data type is set of values and set of operations, right? Now coming to our discussion of interest, that is classes. What is a class consists of? It consists of fields and methods. Is it right or not?
Yes, sir.
What are these fields? They are nothing but the variables, right? Int height and int width. So can we store some values in the height and width or not?
Yes, sir.
Right.
So is it not the set of values? Right. Is it not the set of values?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is a set of values. And I am saying that class also consists of methods read and write in this case, right? And this read and write can be operated only on these values. Is it not the set of operations?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now tell me whether a class can be treated as a data type or not.
Yes, sir.
Right, super, right? So a data type is nothing but a set of values and set of operations. By definition, we know that. And when we define a class, we are going to define some set of values and we are going to define some set of operations. Therefore, a class can also be called as a data type which is user defined. So we can simply say that a class is a user defined data type. Nothing wrong in it, right? Nobody says that you are wrong, right? So a class is nothing but a user defined data type. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Right. Now we will move to another concept. We know what a class is. We are saying that it is a blueprint or it is a prototype or it is a user defined data type. You can define anyway. Nothing wrong, right? And we know how to declare a class and what a class consists of. All these things we know, right? And coming to object, it is called as the instance of a class. We need to create object for the class. In order to make use of this class, we should create object, right? You can create n number of objects for a class. There is no restriction. There is no restriction on how many objects you are going to create for a particular class. It is your choice that you can create in n number of objects, right? So how do you declare an object? This is important. How do you declare an object, right? So there are two ways of declaring the object. Actually, we'll say that creation and declaration. Declaration is different from creation, right? We'll see. So there are two methods of declaring the object. One is, for example, we'll take an analogy. How do you declare an integer variable? How do you declare an integer variable? Okay. Int A. What is this int here?
Integer.
Data type. That is. What is this A here?
Variable.
Right. So int is a predefined data type or it is a fundamental data type. Now I have my own defined data type, user defined data type. What is the name of that user defined data type I have defined here?
ABC.
So in the same way, you give the ABC. And after that, A is nothing but the variable name. Here I will create one object O1. Simple thing, right? So can you generalize this one? I have given a specific thing for this class. O1 is the object name and ABC is the class name. So when we generalize this thing, the syntax for creating an object is class name followed by space followed by, what is that one? Object name. That's it, right? So this is one method of declaring an object. Is it clear?
Well, no.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. So this is first method. And what about the second method? Yesterday we have discussed it, the second method, right? The same thing happens like this only. First you have to declare the object like this with class name followed by object name. And you have to use an assignment operator which is equal to, and you have to use an operator called new, right? New followed by class name of. This is another method of creating the object. Right. There is a difference between these two. What is the first method we have declared? Just class name followed by object name. Like this. A, B, C followed by O1, comma O2, comma O3 and so on. Right. That is confined as to only three objects. So how many objects I have created here?
Three.
So this is called as object declaration. Remember that at this particular point, no memory is allocated for the object. Right. No memory is allocated for the object. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now let us go with the second method. This is my second method too. Here I am using the class name. Okay. And I am using the object name. Up to here, we know that we have created an object. It's the same as that of method one. This is method one. Right. And we are using an assignment operator and we are using an operator called new. What for this new is used? Can anybody tell me?
Dynamic allocation.
Please don't tell me that it is dynamic allocation, the memory allocation, right? Memory allocation. Okay. Memory allocation in C++ is done by using two operators, memory allocation and deallocation. Memory allocation is done with the new operator and deallocation is done with the
delete
operator. Super. Right. So I am using a new operator. Therefore, I am asking the compiler to allocate the memory at this point. And after new, we have the class name and parenthesis. Can anybody tell me what is the syntax? This syntax is similar to something. What is that one? Is it similar or not?
Function.
So this is a function. Super. So this is a function. So the function, this function is having the same name as the class name. Right. If you go through the example, specific example, ABC O1 is equal to new ABC of. Right. Of. This is the specific example we are giving. So ABC is the class name, O1 is the object name, is equal to new is the operator to allocate the memory. For what it will allocate the memory? Can anybody tell me?
ABC.
No, no, it's not for ABC. It is going to allocate class memory. What is that one?
Class name.
New no. ABC. New ABC.
New ABC is correct only. This is the syntax, right? But I am saying that new is an operator which is used to allocate memory. For what it is going to allocate the memory? You go to the class, you go to the class definition, then you can understand for what you can allocate the memory. Okay, object is okay, Amma, but whenever you create an object, this object is having four fields. What are those four fields? It has two fields. One is the int height and another one is int width. And it has two methods, read and write.
Memory function.
Right. New is a memory function. It is a function. It is not function. It is an operator which is used to allocate the memory. But for what it is going to allocate memory? If you go to the class definition, it consists of two fields, int height and int width. So for these two fields which are specified inside the class, it is going to, the new is going to allocate memory for these two fields. What are those two fields? Height and width. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
And what about this height and width? To which object they belong?
Set of values.
This height and width belongs to which object?
O1.
Super, right? It is O1. Right, whenever you create objects, declaration is this one. This is creation, right? Whenever you create objects, then memory will be allocated for each and every object separately. For example, if I take another thing. OBC, O2, new ABC. Right. Now in this case, what is the name of the object?
O2.
Now if I am said, I'm saying new. Therefore, I know that this is an operator which allocates memory. So to which fields it is going to allocate the memory?
Height and width.
So it is going to allocate memory for height and width that belong to O2 object. Right. So remember that, as I told that you can create any number of objects for a particular class. One class, many objects. And each and every object will have its own fields, right? So height and width will be allocated to O1, height and width will be allocated to O2. Therefore, both of them are having different fields, right? Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now see, what is this ABC of? I told you that this is a function, right? It appears as if it is a function, right? But a function is having the same name as the class name. Is it right or not? What is the class name here? ABC. What is the function name here?
ABC.
So this particular function is called as a constructor. We have the concept of constructors and destructors in the second unit. Right. So we'll start the second unit in tomorrow's class. Don't worry. So this is called as a constructor. What is a constructor? If somebody asks you what actually is a constructor, what do you say?
It is a function.
Super. It is a function, but it has some special property. What is that property? It is a function which is having the same name as that of the class. Right. That particular function is called as a constructor. We'll see what happens, what is the use of these constructors and what are the types of constructors in unit 2. Don't worry about it. But for this point of time, you just remember that a constructor is a function which has the same name as the class name. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So this is method 2 where you are creating the objects, and this is method 1 where you are defining the object, where you are declaring the object. That's it, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. Yes, sir. One point again. This is, I'm just rewriting method 2, right? So method 2 is class name space object name is equal to new constructor. Is it right? Now can I divide this into two parts? One is class name. First, I will declare the object like this, object name. And in the second statement, I will write like this, object name is equal to new class name of. Right. Can I divide like this?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you can divide it. Right. This is similar to that of method 2 only. But you are dividing it into two parts. The first part is you are declaring the object, and second part is you are creating space for the object. That's it, right? So object name is equal to new class name. So whenever it creates a space, then that memory address will be stored inside this object. That's it. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
So we had an in-depth discussion on these classes and objects. Why? Because I told you, right, these are the two important concepts that form the base for designing the real world objects or real world problems. So we had a lot deep discussion onto this. Again, we'll discuss these concepts when we go to unit 2. Don't worry, right? So this is how we have done. We completed this one, and let us see what a class differs from the objects, right? A class in object-oriented programming is called as a blueprint or the prototype that defines the variables and methods. Is it right or not? And it is common to all the objects of a certain kind. Certain kind means the of that particular class. That's it. Right. So in object-oriented programming, a class is this is the actual definition, right? A class is a blueprint or a prototype that consists or that defines the variables and methods. Methods are nothing but functions, right? which are common to all the objects. But an object in verbs is a specimen or the instance of a class. It is a specimen or instance of a class. And software objects are often used to model real world objects which you come across in your daily life. Right. So the classes and objects play a very important role to design or to model the real world problem. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now coming to the next important point, this is one of the powerful tool we have in object-oriented programming, which is called inheritance, hereditary. This particular term is taken from hereditary. Can anybody tell me what do you mean by hereditary properties?
Passing down through generations.
Right. You acquire some properties from your parents. For example, somebody will come and say that your eyes look like your mother. Right. Somebody will say that you look like your father. So the thing is that as a child, you are going to acquire some properties from your parents. Not only the parents, you can also acquire the properties from the grandparents also. Right. Or you can acquire the properties from your aunt also, right? Or from your uncle. Like that, you may acquire some properties from the other classes or other people, right? In the similar way, the inheritance in object-oriented programming is defined as the process. It is a process where one class, right? These definitions are very important. Where one class acquires the properties, methods, and fields of another class. Right. So you have assume that you have two classes, class A and class B. So if you can inherit from A, what do you mean by inheritance? Means once you inherit a class from another class, the properties or the fields or the methods that are present inside this A are also acquired by B. This is called as inheritance. For example, let us take two variables X and Y that are present are declared inside this class A. Okay. And assume that class B has been inherited from class A. That means class B consists of X and Y. It consists of both the properties of the super class, which is called as A, right? And in addition to this X and Y, you may have, that means the child class may have some other properties like A, B, C, and Z, right? So it has its own properties. The child class has its own properties. And since it is inherited from a super class, it also acquires the properties of that super class also. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, and the use of this inheritance is it arranges the things in the hierarchical order. Is it the hierarchical order or not? Hierarchical means level by level. So the parent class or the super class will be at one level. This is the top level. And the child classes, for example, assume that you have acquired another class or you have inherited class C from A. This means that X and Y are the properties acquired from A, and assume that E, F, G are its own property. So how many properties does C have right now? It has 5 properties. 3 of its own, which are E, F, and G, and 2 are from its super class, that is from its parent class, which is X and Y. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So
yes,
when you inherit a class from another class, remember that the class which is inherited consists of its own properties as well as the properties of the parent class. Right. So it makes the information to be arranged in the hierarchical order. Right. And you should know the terminology. Here we have few more terminologies. So here A is called, here this particular A is the class from which we are inheriting. Therefore, this is called as parent class. This can be called as parent class. or it can also be called as base class, or it can also be called as super class. Right? There are different terminologies from the for this particular class. What are those terminologies? It can be called as the parent class, it can be called as the base class and super class, anything you can use, right? Similarly, B and C are the classes which are in which are inherited, right? It is going to inherit from A. So we have some special names for this B and C. Parent, therefore we will get it as child, right? So whenever you use the parent class terminology, you have to use it as child class terminology, right? Or base class. Base class is something different from what is the here we call it as derived class. And another name is subclass. Right. Parent and child, right? Base class and subclass, base class and subclass, right? Super class and derived class. You can interchange these words also, but parent and child, these are the related. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now going to one more important concept that is related to object-oriented programming, that is polymorphism. Poly. What do you mean by poly?
Many.
Right. Morphing. Have you ever heard of the term morphing?
Yes.
No. Tell me the exact meaning of morphing. Somebody will take your picture and they will not duplicate actually. They will change it. Right. Somebody will take your picture and they will morph it. That means they will make your nose look like something swelling, or they will make your mouth expanded or shortened like that, right? That is called as morphing, right? So it is called as form. You can take it as form, right? So if we transfer this term polymorphism into actual English terminology, it is called as many forms. It's called as many forms. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So what do you understand by this polymorphism? It allows us to use the same word to mean different things in different contexts, right? So you take some word, for example, you take the function f. The same function can be used to add integers, and the same function can be used to add float, and you can write a code such that it adds both f1 integers and float, right? Here we have only one function. What is that function name? Only f, right? But it is going to, it is being used to add two integers. It is used to add three integers also. It is used to add two floating point values, or it can be made, you write a code such that it adds both integer and float, right? So one word or one entity, it is performing many tasks in different contexts. That is called as polymorphism. It is going to take many forms. So we have only one entity, but it is going to take many forms. It can be used to add integers. It can be used to add floats. It can be used to add both integer and float, right? So one form, one name, many forms, right? One name.
Many forms
are implementations also, you can say. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So here you make a method in such a way that it is capable of doing different things. This is what we have discussed, right? There is only one function, that and that function is used to add integers. It is used to add float, integer and float, right? So one method will make it to do different tasks, right? And it is going to take many forms based on the object that it is going to act upon, right? So in other words, polymorphism allows you to define only one interface and have multiple implementation. These are all different terminologies, right? So if you observe this first statement, and if you observe the second statement and third statement, all are similar only. All the three statements are similar only, but they are expressed in different things, right? So you can make use of any particular statement to define a polymorphism. Or simply, if somebody asks you what polymorphism is, you can simply say that it is going to multiple forms, right? Many forms. A single entity going to perform multiple tasks in different contexts. You can define like that. Or a single entity or a single interface which is capable of performing multiple implementations. Like that also you can define, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And we have abstraction. This is very important concept, which is called as abstraction. What do you mean by abstraction? Abstract. Can anybody tell me what you mean by abstract? Any idea on abstract? Yes or no?
Imaginary.
Right. So anything in this world is an abstract thing, right? Except few things. Anything you come across in your daily life is an abstract thing. I will give a real time example. So you have mobile phones, right? Smartphones, not mobile phones. Everybody is having smartphones, right? You know how to make a call, you know how to cut a call, you know how to send an SMS, you know how to send an MMS, all these things you know, right? As an end user, you know how to operate your mobile. But as an end user, you are not interested to know what actually is happening inside it. Have you ever tried to open your smartphone and try to see how you can make a call and what are the circuits that are involved in it? And what are the sensors that are embedded into your mobile phone? Have you ever tried that one?
Yes, sir.
You have tried to open your mobile phone, right?
Yes, sir.
Listen to the class and answer the question, right? Have you ever tried to open your mobile phone to see what sensors are there, what circuits you have used in the mobile phone?
No, sir.
No, right? So as an end user, you just want to make use of those objects and you are not interested to know what actually is coded inside, what actually is embedded inside, right? Similarly, if you take a TV remote, you know how to change the channel, you know how to increase the volume, you know how to turn on and turn off the TV, but you never try to know what is there inside the remote and how it is going to operate and how the IR is going to control the TV, right? So that is called as abstraction. Abstraction means hiding the implementation details is called as abstraction. What is that one? Repeat it.
Hiding
the implementation details from the user is called as abstraction, right? So here in object-oriented programming, we will hide what code you have given to implement a particular object, right? As I'm saying that object-oriented programming is used to model the real world problems, right? After you model the real world problems, you release it to the world, external world, and people make use of that particular thing, and nobody is interested to know what code you have written inside it, right? So this is called as abstraction. This is called as abstraction. Abstract means hiding the implementation details is called as abstract. Remember this term. And previously I have one term that was introduced in the previous slide, that is ADT. What do you mean by ADT?
Abstraction data type.
It's not abstraction data type, it is abstract data type, right? We know what data type is. Data type is nothing but the set of values and set of operations that we can perform on those values. Now you tell me what is abstract data type. We know what abstraction is. Now you tell me, we know what abstraction is, we know what data type is. Now you have to combine these two terms and you have to tell me what abstract data type is.
Imaginary data types.
No, not imaginary. Imaginary is something different. I told you that data type is a set of values and set of operations, right? And I told you that abstraction is hiding the implementation details. Now you tell me what this abstract data type.
Hiding the set of values.
Super. You are somewhat closer, right? So you hide the set of values and you hide the code for the methods also. We have set of operations, right? Operation is nothing but a function. Function is nothing but set of instructions. So all those set of instructions and set of values will be hidden from the user. That is called abstract data type. Why we need to hide these all these details? Any guess on it? I don't want exact answers, but you just try to give a answer.
To avoid extra work.
To avoid? No. I am hiding something from you. I'm hiding something from you. For example, I had some 2 lakhs of money with me. I don't want to expose to you. What does it mean? Why I'm hiding that particular thing?
Privacy.
Security.
Security. Super. Right. So I want to secure my 2 lakhs of amount. I don't want to expose that I contain 2 lakhs with me. Right. I have 2 lakhs of money with me. Right. This is for the security purpose. Similarly, when I say that ADT, abstract data type, I know that data type consists of set of values and set of operations. I know abstraction is hiding the implementation details. So ADT means I'm hiding the data as well as the method implementations from the user. So this provides the security. One of the important aspect of the object-oriented programming is they are more secure than the procedure-oriented programming. That's what we have discussed, right? While discussing the differences between OOPs and POP, we have discussed that it provides more security. Is it clear? How it is going to provide more security means it does not expose the data. One important point or difference between this OOP and POP is POP concentrates more on data functions. Listen careful and answer. POP concentrates, or emphasis will be given in POP on data or functions. We have two things. One is data and operations. Data values and operations. And POP concentrates on which one? Is it on data or functions?
Functions.
Super, right. What about the OOP?
Data.
The emphasis is on data. So it won't allow the data to move freely from one entity to another entity or one class to another class. So it provides more security. So security, we have different things that encapsulation provides security, abstraction provides security. So these are all the various constructs or the concepts that are embedded in C, that are included in C++, which provides the security. Right. So now tell abstraction, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So it allows us for simple things to represent the complexity, right? And such as objects, classes, variables representing more complex underlying code and data. So you never expose what data is present inside your class. You never expose what type of instructions you have given for the functions that are defined inside the class. Everything is closed. It's a closed box, right? Nobody knows what is happening inside the class. What is there inside the class? That is called as abstraction. And abstraction is possible because of these objects and classes, right? Now, as a real example, I told you that you know how to turn on the TV, but you don't know how it works. You just know how to turn on the TV and enjoy it, right? You don't know how it has been implemented, what circuits have been used in the remote control or TV. All these things are not confined, right? Similarly, if you consider library files, for example, I say that stdio.h. What is this stdio.h? Standard input output dot h, right? Header file. As a first statement in the C programming language, I will write it as hash include stdio dot h, right? So I know that stdio dot h consists of printf and scanf, and I know that in order to make use of this printf and scanf in my program, I have to include this stdio dot h. Have you ever tried of explore? Have you ever opened this stdio function that are defined or declared inside this stdio.h? You never do it, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So that is also called as abstraction. Real life example. One thing we have seen the real life examples in case of mobiles and in case of TVs, TV remotes, our refrigerators, air conditioning units, everything is abstract in this world, right? And one example from the programming point of view, is the header files which we use in the programming. We just declare it and add it to our program. We never try to open that particular file and explore those files. So that is called as abstraction, right? So we are bothered, we are very much interested to use those particular entities, but you never bother about how those entities are made and what they are made. That is the important, right? That is called as abstraction. We have only one concept after this abstraction. I will close that session, right? Don't worry. So this is very important because it lets avoid repeating the same work. We'll see why these classes and objects avoid repetition, all these things we'll see, right? Are you clear about this abstraction?
Yes, sir.
So, and the last concept we have is the encapsulation. Encapsulation means it is a mechanism of wrapping of data variables and code acting on the data. What are the data variables? Can I call them as fields?
Yes, sir.
Right. And the code acting on those data, can I call them as methods?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, what is the combination of fields and methods?
Set of values.
No. Fields are set of values, methods are set of operations. So, I have these fields and methods and I am combining it into one single entity.
Class.
Which is called as class.
Yes.
Right. Super. Class. So I am wrapping. Wrapping means chuttatamamma, right? I am combining. I am making it as a single entity. And then the fields and methods. That is nothing but I am wrapping the data variables and the code that acts on the data together into a single unit, which is called as class. This is called as encapsulation. Capsule. You can remember the term capsule. So a capsule consists of different combinations of chemical products, and they are combined. And they are kept in a single capsule.
Unit.
You can remember like this. So it is called as encapsulate. Don't. This is the analogy that I am using to remember easily. Right? Encapsulation means it consists of different data variables and codes. They are wrapped into a single entity, which is called as class. That is called as encapsulation. So don't write these type of answers in the examination. Right? Encapsulation, it is an analogy of capsule. A capsule consists of different combinations of chemical products and it is enclosed into a single capsule. Don't write all these things, right? So you should give the exact definition. Encapsulation is a mechanism of wrapping up of data variables and code acting on data methods together as a single unit, which we call it as class. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So the various, listen carefully. And out of these data variables and methods, I have two things, right, in a class, fields and methods. Now tell me which is important here. Is it fields or methods? What we should emphasize on, either the fields or methods?
Fields.
Super. Why? Because we are making use of whoops concept, and whoops always emphasize on data. That means it tries to store the data, or it tries to hide the data from the external entities, right? So fields should be secured. That means that data should be secured. When you secure the fields, that means you are securing the data. This is what the main reason for implementing the whoops. You should emphasize on data. You should not let the data to move freely, right? So the variables of a class will be hidden from other classes. So you don't allow this data to be visible to the other class, just 2 minutes. So we won't allow these fields to be visible to the other class, right? We'll see how we will hide these fields. All these things we'll see in the next unit, right? And remember that I'm saying that these fields are not accessible to the external world. Then how can I make use of this data, sir? You may get a question like this, right? You can make use of data, or you can access the data in a class only with the methods that are declared inside this class. Whatever methods you declare inside this class, those methods are only having the access to this data. No other entity is having access to this data within this class. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Are we hiding the fields from the external world or not? Yes, we are hiding. So how can we make use of this data, sir? Without making use of data, what is the use of declaring this in the class? You may get a question like that. Yes, you can make use of this data. You can access this data, but the accessing of data within a class is restricted to only the methods that are declared inside the class, right? So this is called as data hiding, right? We are going to hide the data. How we are going to hide the data? By using access specifier. And how we are going to access the data? By making use of methods that are declared inside the class only, right? Right. Listen, to achieve encapsulation, we declare variables of a class as private. That is what I am saying. How we are going to protect the data? By making use of access specifiers. We'll see these things in the next unit. So we have three types of access specifiers: public, private, and protected. All of them start with P only. Public, private, and protected. Private means it is only accessible within this class. So whenever you make the data as private, then you can hide the data from the other entity. Right. And the main purpose is we can reuse the objects like the code components or variables. And this is particularly used for reusability. We'll see all these things. Right. What is encapsulation? It is a mechanism of wrapping up of data variables and code or the methods into a single entity, which we call it as class. And we protect the data from external world. That means we will hide the data from the external world, by which is called as data hiding. Right. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
One. Yeah.